Vamos iniciar mais esta sessão das Quintas do Mar. Eu sou a Sónia Costa, que vou estar a moderar esta sessão. Sou bióloga no Polo da Madeira. Hoje temos connosco o colega Juan Samper Valverde. Ele vai fazer uma apresentação sobre as estruturas de defesa costeira, portos, marinas e quebra-mares, impactos no ecossistema e soluções recentes de engenharia ecológica, engenharia azul. E o Juan, desde 2019, que está a fazer o doutoramento no Departamento de Zoologia da Universidade de Sevilha, em Espanha, sob a orientação do professor Guerra Garcia, e os seus interesses na área da investigação enquadram-se nas áreas da biologia marinha costeira e na ecologia e conservação. Ele também tem experiência em habitats e espécies protegidas e na ecologia de espécies não indígenas. Faz também experimentação em mesocosmos. Atualmente ele está a trabalhar na quantificação dos impactos ecológicos da urbanização costeira e no desenvolvimento de medidas de mitigação, como a engenharia azul, e é sobre isso também que ele hoje nos vai falar. Desde junho que o Juan está connosco aqui no Polo da Madeira a fazer uma parte da sua investigação e, em concreto, ele está a realizar um estudo sobre os impactos das estruturas de defesa costeira e os efeitos dos materiais que são utilizados na sua construção nas comunidades bentónicas marinhas. Portanto, se depois, se houver alguma dúvida, então relembro que devem inscrever-se no chat. E vamos dar início então à apresentação. E obrigada pela vossa presença. Juan, quando quiseres.
Hola, boa tarde. Thank you, Sonia, for the presentation. First of all, thank you for the invitation. I will put also the camera here so you can see my face. I guess you can see now my face. And this is the topic I'm working on, no? It is a topic that, as I say, it is growing because nowadays we depend, well, always in the history of the civilization, we depend on the sea, but also now, even more, no? And it is so that half of the population of the world live near to the coast, and most of the, well, lot of big cities are in the coastal areas. And also, a very big percentage of the world trade of the commerce is on the vessel in the sea. So up to 90% of the commerce and the movement of goods from one part of the to the other of the world are made by the sea, these big vessels, no? And as a response of all these needs, the coastal urbanization, the vessels, also as a defense of these cities and the coastal population from the storms and floodings, we are constructing more and more the coastal ecosystem. And there are so some areas that are totally constructed, like in this picture that you can see here in the left. And normally we do so adding stones to the bottom of the sea. That can be stones that we get from quarries from the earth, or concrete stones like blocks or tetrapods, etc. These structures are starting to become a problem to the health of the cities, and they have problems of accumulation of marine litter, several problems that are starting to arise, some also ecological problems, some research trying to improve the ecological status of these areas. No, as I say, nowadays, due to the global change, it is more likely that there will be more storms, and with a more quantity of a storm and with more intensity. No, and we are constructing to protect our houses, are the places that we live on, from these storms. But there are several problems. One of them is that when you construct a port to protect the or a quebra-mar to protect the boats or the houses, you are modifying the dynamic of the coast. The coastal dynamics and the currents are changing on the coast. So where there was a beach, now the beach is disappearing. The sand is doing sedimentation in other places, no? And this affects directly to kind of living that is the tourism and the coastal ecosystems that live on this beach, the dunes and the vegetation on those areas. But also, when you construct a port, normally you are changing the ecosystemic the value of the water inside it. No, you are enclosing a water body without renovation, and the pollution and the litter and a lot of contaminants are getting inside, and this is lowering the quality of life of the cities and other coastal areas. Nowadays, this is becoming very, very important because most of the cities that are increasing in economic importance, that are increasing in wealth and in the quality of living, they are investing a lot of effort in having a good environment, the city environment, no? Like the green construction, the ecological engineering of the buildings, have a lot of parks and green areas that they are good for the health and also for the mental health of the people. And especially now in the situation of the pandemic, there has been studies relating these areas that you can do a walk in a park and go out for a little bit of nature with a better status of the mind, less depressions and that kind of stuff, no? But now we are starting to extrapolate this to the marine environment. We are starting to put these ideas that we need a more healthy ecosystem around us to improve the quality of the places where we live, also in the sea. And you have a picture here, for example, after a storm, how the beaches are full of garbage and that kind of things, no? Also, there are some problems that are related to the artificial structure and the traffic of the boats that are on them, like the introduction of alien species, the construction that are damaging the ecosystem, the turbidity, etc. No? So this is an issue that has a lot of faces, and we have to take care of all of them to try to impact less the environment when we are living in the coastal areas, and also improve the quality of life. Well, one of the most important issues or ecological impacts on those structures are the heavily modified water bodies. This is the name. It is when you construct a port and encapsulate, like you enclose a water mass. So you can see here, on the left, there is a port with very little flushing time. Flushing time means that you have here the mouth of the port in the left, and the water is entering and going out with the wind, the tides, etc. But in the more innermost part of the port, the areas where are less open, the water is remaining there for a lot of time, and it is heating up or changing the temperature, the salinity, etc., and have a different condition that the condition that are normally in this coastal area. No? Here in Madeira, it is very significant because we are in an oceanic or even in the coastal areas of Portugal, in an oceanic ecosystem with a lot of water flushing. So the water is constantly renovating, and it is coming with some conditions, and we are totally modifying these conditions when we build a port. And inside this port, there are totally different ecosystems than the one that you can find outside the port. As a result, the communities, the marine communities, like the algae, sponges, a lot of animals and plants of the marine area, they cannot colonize and live inside these structures. And they are being replaced by another animals and algae that are coming in the boats. So we are here in Madeira Island, the marinas and ports are the most invaded habitats of all the island, the marine areas. So these species that are normally coming from tropical ecosystem, they are more resistant to the lack of oxygen, the differences of temperature, they are more resilient, and they thrive inside these ports and these structures. And it is can be a problem because they can go out of the structure and start colonizing the natural areas and start causing important economic, social, and even health problems. in Sevilla. I was I've been working with the Ruloptera okamurae, an Asian algae that it is now has invaded practically all the ecosystems of the Strait of Gibraltar, and it is expanding to the Mediterranean. But this is only one species of all the species that we have. NIS, it is called the non-indigenous species that are coming from other ecosystems of the world, and most of them they don't succeed. They just or die or establish populations that in rare cases can sustain themselves, but from time to time there is one species that comes to an area and colonize everything and start causing a lot of problems, no? And one of the factors that are favoring these situations are the ports, because it is a hotspot of invasions. So here in the right, you have from this paper, Bonamano et al. 2017, that they simulated the same scenario of the port, but with two entrances. Here down in the right, they open another mouth of the port. So the port has two mouths, and now the water is flowing inside the port. So you can see how in this area that before the water was almost 1 week before it was washed away. Now the washing time is much, much less, even less than 1 day or few hours. In few hours, the water here, it is going away. So this is this water is not going to heat up or change the environmental conditions so much as the water that we have in the previous scenario. As you may see here, you have the the legend of the figure, and it is different. So here in this area of the port that in the previous simulation was more or less, you can say, okay, it is more or less in a good quality. Now it is a bad quality. It's 50 hours until it is washed, the water inside, no? So you can see how these colors are not the same, the two figures, and have the environmental condition of the port have increased and are much better now when we open a second entrance. This is not so easy as it sounds, because one of the problem of the ports, it is that the water is moving less inside, so you have a lot of siltation and a lot of sediment that from time to time you have to invest a lot of money to take out those sediments so the port can be, can the boats can enter in the port. So maybe you have also to work with, this is a problem that has to be solved from a multidisciplinary way. You have to work with engineers, the people that can do hydrodynamic models, and also how to predict the scenario of storms, how is the resistance of these structures. So when you open a second mouth of the port, it is not meaning that you will have a huge increase in the maintenance costs, and it will be not impossible to maintain this port, and it will become a beach practically, no? So this is a multifaceted problem. Well, another, it is all these factors that contribute to modify the coastal ecosystems. From all of them, I think that the heavily modified water bodies is one of the most important ones. But also, when you are constructing a port, you can see here that it is not designed to sustain different kind of lives. You can see this is in Madeira. Here they have the Mare Lab. This is a old picture, but now this is a hotel complex, and here we have the lab. And you can see here, this is a natural coast. You can see the mouse, no? I guess, yes. You have a natural coast that it is very heterogeneous. It has a lot of complexity. And when you compare it with the brick water protection of the port, this brick water is totally linear. Here down, this is the airport of Madeira. Down of the airport, there is also artificial structures, and it is totally flat. So it is forming a line. This is mean that you have not so many microhabitat complexity, because if you see the natural coast, you have a lot of complexity here that it is making one area it is in shadow, another area is receiving more solar light, one area is more exposed to the waves, another area is more protected. All the organisms that live in the coastal areas, the marine ecosystems, they are adapted to certain conditions. Like if you have a forest and the soil is one pH or the other pH, you will have one kind of species of trees or another kind of species of trees. They are more adapted to a certain microhabitat or a certain conditions where they are more competitive, no? So, but here in the port, this is most of it is only one kind of light exposition, one amount of wave exposition, and this makes that a lot of species that are living in the natural areas cannot colonize the port. So for them, the port, he says, imagine you are a limpet or a snail living in the right part of the port, and when you reproduce, you can only reproduce with the limpets that are next to you. The limpets that are on the other side of the port, you are not reproducing with them. There is no genetic exchange. So you are creating barriers in the marine environment because this snail cannot colonize the breakwater of the port. Also, what this do is that the community that lives in the breakwater of the port, they have less competition, a minor level of competition, because there are less species that can live here, more open spaces, and this leaves open niches for the species to colonize, and the non-indigenous species that we speak before, that are coming with the boats and etc., they can also colonize these areas of the port in the breakwaters. This also happens with the vertical walls. If you see even a cliff in the coast will never be a total flat surface, like you have here in this picture, or here with a colleague is looking the some limpets living in this flat surface. The limpets, for example, they live in the intertidal area, which means the area from the low tide to the high tide. Imagine that when the tides go down and then go up, this is the vertical space, the vertical amount of space that they can colonize these limpets. If you have a totally vertical wall, very flat, you are reducing very much the area for this species to live, and you are creating a handicap to them, so they will be in less numbers or even not colonize these structures. And normally in the natural areas, the intertidal and other, they have some complexity, they have some irregularity that it is making multiplying this area. At the end, you are giving more space to the organism to live. So what we are coming here is that from the last decades, we have realized that when we construct an area, this area is becoming very poor in species, in ecosystem services. There is a very low ecological value of these areas, no? And it is important to maintain our ecosystem healthy because of a lot of factors. From maintaining the resource that we take from the sea, for example, the fisheries, or etc., or even for the health of the human beings. Nowadays, we are taking a lot of molecules from the sea for the medicine, the pharmaceutical companies, the engineering technology. It is called the biotechnology. And if we are impacting the seas and the ecosystems, and we are potentially making the species disappear, those are molecules that are going to have a use probably in the future. For example, not so much years ago, I guess 4 or 5 years ago, a group of the UK, they discovered a new biomaterial from the teeth of the limpets. The limpets have some teeth that they use for scratching the rocks to eat the algae that grow on the rocks. And these teeth are made from a compound of iron. And it is a kind of material that it is one of the most resistant materials that we know nowadays. And they will have application of the aerospatial engineering and a lot of application for the technology, no? In a simple limpet that normally you cannot expect that they will make us a new advancement on the technology. So, as a response of this loss of biodiversity and all those impacts that we are creating on the coastal areas, There has been a lot of initiatives to create a more sustainable artificial structure that create less impact on the coastal ecosystems. And even one of the impacts, it is only to add new rocks to the coastline because those rocks have to be colonized and normally has less biodiversity than the rest areas. But with recent studies, they have demonstrated that when you add microhabitats to those structures, you will increase the biodiversity and the ecological status of the artificial structures. Here we have tide pools that normally, when you have breakwater made of flat concrete cubes, you will not have tide pools in the intertidals. But when the tide goes down, the mare leaves a pool full of water. This is an ecosystem, a microhabitat, a small habitat that it is missing in the traditional artificial structure. And when we add this kind of pools to the sea walls and the breakwaters, we increase their ecological status. Like this ecosystem, there are lots of ecosystems. For example, what we talked before, that the breakwaters are aligned. If you are making a breakwater that has more orientations and inclinations and etc., you are potentially adapting that breakwater to have more species. But in any case, most of the efforts for protecting the coastal areas and to defend ourselves from the storm and etc. are coming from the natural solution. For example, the mangroves that you have here in the middle up, there's the presentation. This picture is a mangrove that has been cut for a lot of places in Central America and South America, but they are perfect protection against the storms. And also they are acting against the erosion of the coastline. And also, there are new papers that are taking into account that these mangroves are the perfect sink of microplastic and plastics. So when the garbage come here to the mangrove, it gets in the between the roots and it gets trapped, and then the sediment start covering them. So we are not cleaning but they are starting to enter into the lithosphere. So these mangroves are naturally cleaning the water from the garbage in some sense. Also, the breakwaters are like garbage bins because when you have a lot of blocks and there is a big storm, these blocks move a little bit and the garbage get trapped between the blocks. And there are studies also saying that the breakwaters and the artificial areas are collecting a lot of garbage and a lot of plastics, etc., that are in more quantities than in the natural areas. So this contributes to decrease the quality environmental status of the cities and the coastal areas. Well, we cannot only work on the macro structure complexity and the water bodies, but also the type of rock that we use for constructing the coastal protection structures have an influence on the kind of communities that will grow there. For example, here, this is a very old study. They use metacrylato plate with different rugosities. This one is totally flat. Then you have another one with a little bit of rugosity, then another one with more and more. And you can see that after leaving them for a while in the marine environment, the totally smooth and flat has almost nothing. No animal or plant can grow on that. But as we increase the rugosity of the material, more and more kind of marine life can grow on them. This is related also to the hydrodynamism, because when you have a rough surface, that it is with a lot of regularities, the water that it is, when you have water flow on it is having a turbulent behavior. This means that if you are a small spore or a small propagule that is going to colonize this substrate and you want to stay there to start growing in the colonization, if there is this irregular, this disruption of the limit cap is the like the, you have no linear flow but irregular flow, it is more easy that they will grow there. And if it is totally linear, it is more unlikely that they will grow. Also, the attachment of the marine life that it is growing on that substrate is much stronger if the substrate is irregular. And not only that, but this micro relief, this irregular surfaces on the microscale will create also different micro habitats, where we can call it nano habitats, because you will have an spore that it is or a cell that it is going to attach to the rock, and maybe if when it find a substrate, it doesn't like the kind of light incidence or the kind of hydrodynamics that it is in that substrate, it will go away to find another place to grow. And if you have an irregular substrate, you are giving to that kind of spore more different environmental condition to that, so it's more likely that you will have different kind of life, so more diversity growing to those structures. No, this is in the right an experiment that we did in Ceuta, in the Strait of Gibraltar, for my bachelor degree, and we sink some modules with different kind of rock: sandstone, limestone, gabbro, pizarra, slate, and concrete. And we find out that the sandstone that was highly irregular in the microscale had a faster growing of algae and different kind of biota. But depends also on the composition of the substrate. As we will see, the composition of the substrate is not only the rugosity, but also the chemical properties. You have here from the PhD of Combes, that it is from the UK, he did his PhD on the ecological enhancement of these artificial structures. This is a concrete block, and this was granite and limestone. And you can see that they have different recruitment of the balanus, the cracas. But this is something that it is under discussion, still is under discussion, because from the observation and the experimental approaches that have been done in different parts of the world, some studies found differences in the growth of these animals on different kind of substrate, and another didn't find those differences. No, there are also starting to study the different kind of substrate, the effect that they have on the calcification when simulating a future scenario of acidification of the oceans. And the concrete, if you know, it is a very, very basic material, and it is releasing also to the sea chemical compounds. So there are some authors that argue that in a future climate change scenario of acidification of the water, it could be favoring the calcification of the organism, this material, the concrete, against another kind of rocks like the granite or the basalt, etc. But recent studies by Plymouth group, the Louis Firth, they didn't find difference, because these kind of studies are doing between concrete and rocks. But you can do to the concrete, simulate that it lose the pH, so the effect, and when you do that, there is no differences. So this is not clear how the substrate composition can affect the marine life and the biodiversity. But what it is sure, from a more ecologist point of view, it is that the fabrication of the concrete is one of the activities of the human beings that it is releasing more quantity of the carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, because you have to burn the calcite, and it has a process that it is wasting a lot of energy, and creating a lot of carbon dioxide. So it is not very environmental friendly, this material, the concrete. So in my opinion, the rocks, natural rocks, have a more future on the construction of the port because of this more environmental friendly, that you take them from the quarry and put them on the sea. The problem in this case is that you have also the landscape. You are destructing the landscape of the areas where you make the quarry. But anyways, you also for making the concrete, you also have to take rocks from a quarry. Of course, the concrete is more easy to manipulate, and it is more easy for constructing breakwaters that are more resistant and are dissipating the force of the waves more easily. So the approaches that are being taken nowadays are more focused on the use of the concrete, like we saw before. They do the blocks with the tide pools and different spatial heterogeneity. No, so this is a field that has to be better studied, how the kind of substrate influence the growth of the marine communities. But there are more factors that determining how the marine communities will grow in a rock. For example, here in the left, you have several sporlings of ulva, an algae, that is growing faster in a white substrate than in substrate more dark. And here you have a black substrate. Whoa. Vaya. Un segundo. One second. This is called the albedo. Albedo of the substrate. So the white substrate, it is reflecting more the light, so the ulva can grow faster because it is getting more light. In this case, the light was the limitant factor. But if the limitant factor, it is the availability of nutrients, so probably the color of the rock will have less or no influence of the growth on the growth of the algae. But potentially, the color, even the color of the rock, can have an effect on the community that will grow on that surface, no? Also, the hydrophobicity of the substrate. A more hydrophilic substrate, that means that it is interacting with a higher facility, more easily with the water compounds, water-based compounds. It is more easy for a spore or for a propagule to settle there. So probably it will be colonized faster than here. This is the hydrophilic, than an hydrophobic surface, no? That have different interaction with the fluids that the spore used to attach to the substrate. But as in the natural environment and a lot of kinds of rocks with different properties, in this sense, also the species can adapt to be more fitted to attach to an hydrophilic or an hydrophobic surface, no? And depends, even with more of the studied species have more resistance when they attach to hydrophilic substrate. Also, there are some species that prefer the hydrophobic substrate. So this property of the material will also influence to the community that we will have. You may see there are a lot of factors interacting. So another one, it is the last one that I included in the presentation, is the composition, because calcareous substrate, there are algae or sponges, different animals and plants that can perforate the calcareous substrate using acids, like the Lithophaga lithophaga in the Mediterranean, or even small algae. And this influences also the trophic chains, because you can say here in the middle of the image, you can see this is the radula. These are the teeth of a limpet or of a sea snail, and they are scratching the rocks, and sometimes they are eating the algae that it is growing inside the rock, because this here up left you have the this algae, it is perforating the rock and living under the rock for the only a few micrometers, less than a millimeter, but they can. This cannot happen in another kind of substrate like the granite, because they are siliceous, or they have a composition that it is not dissolving with the acids. So also the composition of the substrate can play a role on the communities that grow on them, if they are made of calcium carbonate or not. In the natural areas, this happens too. There is an Italian team that is working on the effect of substrate on the natural areas, and they found out that in areas dominated by granite, the community, even the fish community, are different from areas dominated by limestone. And they did recently another study on the infralapidical communities that grow under the rocks, because they are more influenced by the substrate, etc., because they have more homogeneous condition, that there are also differences on the communities that live under rocks of different kind of substrate. So the substrate, this is a factor that potentially will influence the communities that we will have when we construct a port. Anyways, a lot of more studies are needed for this. But from what we know, we can apply our knowledge on the artificial structures, like the ports and the big waters, quebra mares. And of course, there are things that we cannot control. For example, the area where we are, for example, here we are in an oceanic island, and you can be in the Mediterranean, in the Pacific. You cannot control the sediment supply that your structure will have. Like if there is you can control it in some way, because you will not, you're constructing a port near an estuary or with a freshwater input inside the port, you will have more sediment, no? But sometimes the city, like Lisbon, for example, is in an estuary. So the sediment supply, it is the sediment supplies that you have in that place. The wave action, for example, here, there is a marina that was totally destroyed by a storm, because here the energy of the sea is very high. Also, the larval recruitment, it is not the same that you are constructing a port near a natural reef, that this natural reef is creating larvae and propagules to colonize the port very quickly, that if you are doing a port in the middle of the Brazil, where each side of the port, there are 200 kilometers of that sandy habitats. So there is nothing, no animal there that can grow on the rocks. The communities are adapted to a sandy environment. Most probably, you will not even have, almost not have a colonization from the natural habitats nearby, because 200 kilometers is a lot of, but maybe you can have some with the more long larval stage, but most of it will come from the fouling of the boats, etc. So it is more likely here that you will have a non-indigenous community, because the only rocky or hard substrate that is interacting with the port is the one of the hulls of the boats, the one of the boats. Also, the tidal amplitude, it is not the same. Again, here in the ocean, a port will change from 2 or 3 meters from the high tide to the low tide. The amount of water that will be washed away with the tide and then enter a new volume of water will be way much higher than the volume that you will exchange in each tide cycle in the Mediterranean, that you have 20 or 30 centimeters tides. So in a port that with the same structure, the same design, in a oceanic place will have a lot of change of water, and in a Mediterranean place you will have almost no exchange of water. The water will stay inside the port for more time. So this is also something that you have to take into account, and you cannot change that. And also the maintenance activities. When you construct a port, it has a life, 20 or 30 years, depending on the place and etc. And you will have to replenish this brick water because it will be, the blocks will be washed away, or it will be eroded, or they will be broken by the storms. And these ports are normally used for commerce, and also usually they are private or they have different legislation. So they have they need a maintenance. We have a huge problem in Ceuta, for example, where we are doing a study with Patella ferruginea, that it is a very highly endangered limpet from the Mediterranean. And this limpet, it has happens that it grows in the port of Ceuta. And in the breakwaters of the port of Ceuta is the biggest population of the limpet in all the world. And it is a highly endangered limpet. So you have a management problem, because from one hand, the limpet, it is highly endangered, you cannot touch even one, and it is growing in a port that it has a commercial activity, it has a contamination, and it needs a reparation, and it needs this is a challenge, no? And one of the solutions that they think about, it is that instead of you have the brick water full of protected limpets, instead of putting the rocks on the top of it at kill of the limpets, you can construct a brick water in front of it, or even small islets that will reduce the energy of the waves, so you don't have to directly kill the limpets. But again, we are this is very difficult to achieve these new interventions in areas, and they are new solutions that need a multidisciplinary approach with engineers and etc. to know if this can work or not. Also, another problem is that normally when you create a protected area, you are creating the area on natural, it is a natural environment. But in this case, it is interesting to create a small protected area inside the port, so that people cannot fish there and cannot do several activities that are damaging this limpet. This is a very exceptional case in the world, and it is not happening almost in any place. Only in South Africa, there is also a port that inside the port there is a seahorse that it is also protected. So this is also a management problem for that port. But these are things that we cannot control. But there are things that we can control. For example, the position of the blocks in the intertidal. There is a new paper that what they did here in the right, you have some stones from the quarry, and they are irregular. And they just, when they are constructing this riprap, the brick water with these stones, there is a marine biologist who went to with the workers and say, okay, this rock in this level and in this position, this rock in this level and in this position. And she helped the organization of the rocks in the brick water. And then they study the colonization of this brick water in which they intervene, and compare it with another brick water that was, has no intervention. And it was the one that they intervened was with more richness and more a number of species, because this person was saying, okay, I want this rock with the hole up, so this hole will create a tide pool. And I want this other rock with the scratches looking outside, so these scratches will be colonized, no? And at the end, this planning, and it was exactly the same, the construction of the brick water, but with the counseling of a marine biologist expert on the topic, and it had better environmental condition and better communities. No, you can also manipulate the block, creating holes, crack, crevices, tide pools. You change the shape and the configuration of the brick water, creating more complexity. You can also change surface roughness, or even create rocks with different roughness, so you will have communities adapted to different roughness, etc. Everything that we talked before, the block arrangement, etc., and the geology of the boulders, the kind of materials, and also the macro scale planning of the port, that you will open two mouths instead of one. All of this, you can modify it, and you can try to create a port that it is more environmental friendly. Anyways, a port will always be an impact in the coastal ecosystems, no? But we cannot live without them, as the civilization is depending on this kind of areas. And it is that what I am here in the Pole of Madeira, of Mare, And I am feeling very welcome with all the help of the people from here, and I am able to do two studies to advance a little bit more in this topic, no, in the island of Madeira, that I think is very interesting because the islands are one of the most urbanized and constructed areas of the world, along with the bays and the the estuaries, and etc. And we are doing an observational study to see if there is differences between the concrete and the natural rock, well, natural the basalt rocks, but everything in the breakwaters. And then we are creating these rocks. They are copies one from each other, and they are made from basalt, the natural rock of the island, concrete, that it is, as I say, very basic, and plastic, the plastic of the plastic bottles, normal plastic bottle, that is the high density polyethylene, I guess. That is the same one that it is used in the pontoons, the floating pontoons for the boats, no? And we plan to put it inside the marinas to hopefully add a little bit more of knowledge and information on the topic of the materials and how they, which material have different properties on the colonization of the benthic communities. And that's it. Thank you very much for holding all the hour, because I saw it is almost 1 hour. Muito obrigado, everyone.